Psalm number 63, verses 1 and 2. And as a matter of fact, we could actually continue reading in Psalm 63. So I perceive that what we will probably end up doing is just starting a place and stopping a place. John chapter 4. Now, I need you, John chapter 4, I need you to have read, which is kind of difficult, I'm sure, but it would be helpful if you will have already read John 4. Of course, if you haven't, there's nothing you can do about it now in terms of the past, except I would encourage you to go and read John 4 at your leisure, so that, and not even at your leisure, do it at your next availability, because we don't have time to read it all today. Great story. Verse 25. The woman saith unto him, I know that when Messiah cometh, which is called Christ, when he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, what seekest thou? Why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then Psalm number 63. Psalm number 63 reads as follows, O God, thou art my God. As a matter of fact, I'm reading the verse, I'm omitting a part of the scripture. A psalm of David when he was in the wilderness of Judah. O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is, to see thy power and thy glory so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Thus will I bless thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips when I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches. Amen. Well, I actually have been ambivalent. As a matter of fact, I realize that we have at least two lessons here. We may have more than two. I've had people sit with me and say, you can go to Exodus 3. Most recently, there was a fellow down in Columbus, an apostle, told overseer to tell me he got at least six sermons out of the lesson that we shared. So, let me give you one more passage. We need to read this. I didn't think of it at the moment. But we do need to read this for you, for all of us, but certainly for you. This is Exodus 3, and you'll see why we need to read this one. Again, it's one of those, if you had already read it, and I'm sure about it, but I'm not sure, so I want to make sure we get it here. And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, so say unto them, the God of your fathers have sent me unto you. And they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am, have sent me unto you. Now, church, as I said, there's a whole lot more in this than we can deal with today. But I'm going to call it what's in my spirit. And actually, the preachers of old have dealt with this text for many years. I just want to use the words for this title today, I am that. Chapter 14, and God said unto Moses, I am that I am. I'd like to call this discussion, I am that. Thank you, Jesus. Our God is a God who reveals himself. As a matter of fact, the only way we know God is that he reveals himself. Here's the word for it. Here's the word for it. He's inscrutable. You know, to scrutinize means to examine. And the prefix in means not. So inscrutable means he's incapable of being examined. Nobody can lay hold upon God. It's all right now, God, let me look at you. How big are you? How strong are you? How much do you know? Nobody can volitionally, arbitrarily choose to scrutinize God. He is inscrutable. The only way that he is able to be known or capable, we are capable of knowing him, is that he reveals himself. He reveals himself. The Bible has everything to do with God revealing himself to mankind. The Bible is the only fully inspired. What I mean by that is other people have written good things, good books that have good principles in them, but there's only one book that is the plenary, verbally inspired revelation of God, and that is the Bible. Genesis through Malachi, Matthew through Revelation, it is the revelation of God. What's the the revelation, when we say revelation or reveal, we mean the unveiling. In other words, God who is hidden from us. He's, you know, sometimes we talk about God being invisible. He's invisible to our eyes, not because he can't be seen, but because we don't have the capacity to see him. Invisible is relative. It's almost like inaudible, something that can't be heard. It's not that it can't be heard. It just means that it can't be heard by human ears, generally speaking. So when someone has a dog whistle, he can blow the whistle and it sounds like nothing to us, but the dog comes running because the dog's sense of hearing is at a higher level of development than that of a human being. Even so, to say that God is invisible or that he's inaudible, whatever, all that means is that our senses are too poor and too weak to be able to lay hold upon the awesome God. But he, in his mercy, chooses at times to unveil himself, to uncover himself, to reveal himself. Even the last book in the Bible, sequentially, that we refer to as Revelation. The word revelation is from the Greek. You understand the New Testament was originally written in Greek. It's from the Greek apokalypsis, which means the unveiling. And by the way, the title of the book, can we deal with that again for just a moment? The title of the book is not Revelations. Isn't that right? Although in many instances, you'll have people say, I'm scared to read that book of Revelations. Isn't that right? There is no book of Revelations. It is the revelation of Jesus Christ.
That's the title of the book. Oh, I know your Bible may have something in there with something different, like the Revelation of St. John the Divine. Some human being put that in there. But the book is originally titled, according to the first few verses or few lines of the book itself, The Revelation of Jesus Christ. The Apocalypsis, our word apocalypse, of Jesus Christ. And it means that God has unveiled Jesus and caused us to be able to see him as we would not see him unless he had unveiled himself. Are you listening to that? I want to talk about that in connection with the name of God. In the book of Exodus, he's named by many names, and all his names reveal him, reveal something about him. The Hebrew, the Old Testament is written primarily in Hebrew. There are names in the Hebrew text such as Elohim, Adonai, Elyon, El Elyon, El Roi, various terms like that. And of course, many of us are familiar with the Jehovistic terms, or Yahweh terms such as Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha or Rofika, Jehovah Nisi. And in the Old Testament, most often Elohim from the Hebrew is translated God, capital G-O-D, okay? And Yahweh or Jehovah, same word, just a different rendering, is most often translated in the Old Testament, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. So whenever you see capital, all four letters capitalized in a traditional King James Version of the Bible, copy of the King James Version of the Bible, then typically that was the word Yahweh or Jehovah rendered in English, Lord. May we talk to you? Okay. Again, Yahweh or Jehovah is essentially the same word. Essentially the same word. Yahweh and Jehovah, essentially the same word. And when you see it written in the King James Version of the Bible, it is not written either, most of the time it's not written Yahweh or Jehovah. It's written capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. Why is that? Well, a number of different reasons. One of them has to do with the ancient tradition of the Jewish people, where they would not write God's full name down. They felt it was too holy to be written down. And when they did write it, they only wrote the consonants. The consonants. They omitted the vowels, okay? Because they felt that his name was so holy. Not only that, but there is another tradition that before they wrote the name of God, they would get up and go take a bath, because they considered his name so holy that they wouldn't even write it if they themselves were less than clean. Isn't that something? And now we've got people who will cuss with it. Isn't that something? But when you have reverence for the things of God, it puts you in position to receive the greater blessing of God. All right. But so he reveals himself all the way, Genesis 1 and 1. In the beginning, God, capital G-O-D, Elohim, created the heaven and the earth. And on it goes, get the second chapter, it starts using the expression Lord God, and so on. But when we get to Exodus chapter 3, a lot has gone on since Genesis. Okay, lots has gone on. Generations have come and gone, and much of the knowledge of God that had been gained or had been obtained at various times may have been lost. Okay, but it's at this point that God reveals himself to Moses and to the children of Israel in a special way. He says, when Moses asked the question, you know, Moses is hesitating. He doesn't want to go down to Egypt. And God says, go. And Moses says, well, tell me now, if I go, you know the people are going to ask, who sent you? And I'm going to say, the God of the Hebrews. I think, so really, well, what is his name? Because in Egypt, they've got all kinds of gods with names. Anybody remember a little Egyptian mythology? Lord, I need to do a better job here. Anybody remember any Egyptian mythology? Horus, Osiris, Isis, Ra, Set, these various ones. Remember them? Well, so what's your God's name? And God speaks out of the burning bush. That's what's going on at this moment. He speaks to Moses and says, go tell them my name is I am. Matter of fact, he told them, I am that I am. Aye, Asher, Aye. Or in other words, I am that I am. Said, when you go tell them I am sent you. I am. Am. I am. Isn't that something? I was looking at a Spanish translation. It said yo soy. That's about right, isn't it? Yeah. I am. God says, I am. Existence. When he says I am, he's saying I am existence itself. He says existence exists in me. Somebody said, well, you know, God, he's in eternity. Well, that's one way to say it, because human beings have to have some kind of parameter. But really and truly, eternity exists in God. He says, I am. Not I was or I will be. I am. Okay? You can render it this way. I was who I will be, and I will be who I already am, and I am. In other words, take the verb to be, which has to do with existence, and put it in whatever conjugated form you choose. When it boils down to it, God says, I am. Yesterday you were. Yesterday I am. Tomorrow you will be. Tomorrow I am. You follow what I'm saying? He says time is a convention that I developed so mankind could have a point of reference. I don't need time. I just am. He is existence itself. And when he begins to reveal himself, he uses that expression, I am, to set himself apart from any other being and any other God. When you fast forward to the book of John, in the Gospel of John, one of the things that makes the people of his day very angry with Jesus is that Jesus keeps sounding like God. He keeps referring to himself in terms that sound a whole lot like what Jehovah or Yahweh said to Moses. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Jesus says, for example, in the book of John chapter 8, when they were bragging about being descendants of Abraham, Jesus said, Abraham, your father Abraham, rejoiced to see my day and did see it and was glad. They said back to Jesus, wait a minute, you're not even 50 years old yet. And have you seen Abraham? Jesus said this, before Abraham was, I am. When he says I, they immediately understood what he meant when he called himself I am. You know what the next few verses say in chapter 8 of the book of John? They took up stones to stone him because they understood he was claiming to be in the New Testament the same person who was in the burning bush in the Old Testament. Are you listening to what I'm saying? And the Bible said that Jesus hid himself from them and passed on through. But he never stopped declaring it. He never stopped saying, I am. The Bible lets us know that in that ninth chapter, he tells them, I am the light of the world. In the tenth chapter, he says, I am the good shepherd. He says, I am the door. Thank God. In the 11th chapter of John, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. In the 14th chapter of John, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus understood exactly what he was doing. He was messing them up because he was claiming to be the same as the God of the Old Testament. And even though they didn't like it, They could not deny that the miracles he was doing, nobody else had done them. Are you listening to what I'm saying? So I need you to understand that as we read through the book of John, thank you, Lord, thank you. As we read through the book of John, what we find is that the problem they have with Jesus is his identity, his am-ness. They don't have a problem with what he does. They have a problem with him healing. They don't have a problem with him working miracles. What they don't like is what he says about who he is. He gets in trouble with them because repeatedly how he identifies himself rubs them the wrong way. Now, I'd like to submit to you as I go a little further with this that the enemy in your life will always be troubled not just by what you accomplish. He's troubled by who you are. And so what he does is that he tries to induce in your life an identity crisis. Because if he can mess with you at the point of who you are, he can ultimately control what you do. That's what he did with Eve. The Bible lets us know that Eve, who is our great, great, great grandmother, God created her along with Adam in his image after his likeness. And yet the devil came to her and said, if you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will be like God. And she did not realize she was already like God. So when the enemy begins to mess with your identity and make you feel that you're less because you don't have this thing, you're less because you don't look this way, you're less because you don't have this height or this shape or this amount of money or this skin color, then when your identity is being challenged, if you ever get unstable in that way, you can be destabilized in every other way. So one of the things that you must be secure about is knowing who you are in God and knowing whose you are, which is, I belong to God. I'm coming on. It's going to make a little more sense just more. Thank you. And notice that when the devil comes at Jesus, he doesn't use new tricks. He may dress him up in new wrappings, but he doesn't use new tricks because the old ones work well enough. When he got to Jesus, he tried to induce in him an identity crisis. What did he say? If you be the Son of God, I want you to prove it. But when you know who you are, it's not necessary for you to prove who you are to somebody who's beneath the dignity of the Inquisition. Those who know that you who you are don't need the proof. And those who need proof won't believe it after you give it to them. Yeah. Hallelujah. And so Jesus refused to play the devil's game. He said, it is written. The devil told him, said, man, if you're the Son of God, why don't you turn these stones into bread? And what did Jesus say? It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. You know what he was saying? Two things. Number one, he was saying, don't play with me. Don't play with me, because what's keeping me alive is not the fact that bread is good for my body. He said, I've been out here 40 days with no bread. And what has kept me alive has been the power of God. Then the second thing he says is that you don't understand who I am, because I'm the one that brought everything that exists into existence anyway. You're talking about turning the stone into bread. Bread came into existence because I spoke my word from the very beginning. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. So I don't need your condescension. I don't need your endorsement. And I want to say to you, brothers and sisters, as I go on with this lesson, make sure that you don't allow the enemy to induce you into an identity crisis because of anything you don't have, or because of any place you haven't been yet, or anything you haven't achieved yet. All you have to do is wait upon the Lord. When the devil offered Jesus kingdoms, Jesus said, I don't have to bow down to you, because I know my destiny is to rule and to reign. And when you know it's your destiny, you don't have to buy what's already yours for free. Listen to this. Here, Jesus begins to identify himself using the expression, I am. He begins to identify with the Father God, and his identity gets him in trouble with those people that he's interacting with. He says in John 5 that he's equal with God. He's the Son of God, which means he's equal. In John 6, he claims to be the bread of life. In John 8, he claims to be, again, the light of the world. In 10, again, the good shepherd and the door. In 18 and 19 of John, he gets in trouble because when Caiaphas asks him, "Are you the Son of God?" he says, "I am." He gets in trouble with Pilate because Pilate asks him, "Are you a king?" And he says, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight for me." And then when Pilate finally crucifies him, he puts over his head a sign that says, "Jesus of Nazareth." And what's supposed to go up here is his crime. And here's his crime: "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." His crime is his identity. I need you to understand that the enemy's greatest insult where you're concerned is that he knows better than you your God-given identity. And so while Moses is still baby Moses, he's trying to kill him because he knows his identity. While Jesus is still baby Jesus, he's trying to kill him because he knows his identity. Some of you have not accomplished anything yet compared to what God has shown you. Some of you have not gone anywhere yet compared to where God said he's going to take you. And yet it seems the enemy is taking off his shoes trying to throw them at you. He's trying to take everything, including the kitchen sink, trying to crush you. You know why? Because he has an awareness of your identity. Shake somebody's hand and tell them, "You can't hide. The enemy knows who you are." Yeah, that's why some of the strange things that we were talking about Thursday. That's why some of the strange warfare that you've been going through, you've been going through it because the enemy knows better than you do that if I don't cut him off now, I'm not going to get a chance in just a little while. Okay, all right, all right. Now, not only does Jesus' identity have significance for his enemies, but his identity also becomes the right kind of sticking point for his friends. In chapter 1, John the Apostle identifies him as the Word. In chapter 1, John the Baptist identifies him as the Son of God and the Lamb of God. In that same chapter, in chapter 2, Andrew identifies him to Peter as the Messiah. Philip identifies him to Nathanael as he of whom the prophet spake. Nathanael identifies him as Christ, the King of Israel. I'm talking about his identity. That's the first chapter. In the second chapter, he reveals himself as the Son of God with power over nature's elements. In chapter 3, Nicodemus recognizes him as the teacher come from God. Chapter 4, we'll talk about it in a moment, the Samaritan woman finds out who he is. In chapter 5, the palsied, impotent man finds out that he is his healer. It is in the 6th chapter that Peter finds out that he's the one that has the word of eternal life. In chapter 7, he reveals that he is the giver of rivers. It is in the 9th chapter that the blind man finds out that he is the Messiah. It is again in the 11th chapter that Mary, Martha, and Lazarus find out that he's a dead man raiser. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It is in the 15th chapter where he reveals himself as the true vine. And in 14, 15, and 16, he reveals himself as the ever-present one in the person of the Holy Spirit. In chapter 17, he reveals himself as the great high priest. In chapter 20, after Caiaphas and Pilate, he reveals himself as the resurrected Lord. And in chapter 20 and 21, he reveals himself as the restoring Savior. He reveals himself. He unveils himself. He causes people to know who he is. And once they find out who he is, their lives totally change. And the point that I want to make to you today is that when you really find out who Jesus is, your life is going to radically change. Oh yeah, I'm almost there. In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, the Bible says that the god of this world, that Satan, has blinded the minds of them that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ should shine unto them.
In other words, the Bible is saying that what the devil does is that he does not want people to know who Jesus really is, so he blinds their mind. Here's my question, brothers and sisters. If Jesus were ugly, if Jesus were undesirable, if Jesus were hideous, if Jesus were abhorrent, if you were the devil, wouldn't you want people to see him as he is? Wouldn't you want people to know just how bad God is and just how undesirable and unpleasant it is to serve God? If you were the devil and God were the undesirable, you'd want everybody to see him so that nobody would want him. If God were undesirable, Satan would not be hiding him. The reason why Satan is trying to hide God from people and hide people from God is because he knows that if they ever get to see him for who he really is, if they ever get his identity right, if they ever get a fix on who he is, he will be found to be irresistible in their lives. And there are some of you that are sitting in this room this morning, this afternoon now, and you have been turned off by God, you think. But the truth be told, it's not God that you've been turned off by. You've been turned off by preachers. Or you've been turned off by deacons. Or you've been turned off by church people. Or you've been turned off by some religion. But I'm not here to advertise a preacher to you. I'm not here to try to get you to accept a deacon. I'm not even here to get you to accept a religion. I'm here to introduce you into a living relationship with the true and living God, the living God who created the heaven and the earth, the same God who created you, the same God who holds your life in his hand. And believe it or not, though you might not think so, you want him more than you realize. You want him. I remember mama and others, but I remember her. They would quote the 23rd Psalm. When I was a child, they would quote the 23rd Psalm and the first verse. And you remember what the first verse of the 23rd Psalm says. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd." It says, "I shall not want." And you see, I was a child. I had a problem with that. I wanted to know. See, I couldn't read. I just heard them say, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not." When they put it right together, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," they said. And I knew what want meant. I knew what want meant. I want some cornflakes. I want some Fruit Loops. I want Superman for Christmas. I want a bicycle. I knew what want meant. And so I couldn't figure out, if the Lord is your shepherd, why don't you want him? I mean, really, that was my question. The Lord is my shepherd. I didn't know anything about a semicolon. I didn't know that the word want was a word that also meant lack, that I'm not going to do without. I thought they meant the Lord is my shepherd, and somehow I don't want him. But you know, believe it or not, that's what the world has been training sinners to believe. The world is training sinners to believe that they don't really want God, because in order to have God, you're going to have to give up pleasure. In order to want God, you're going to have to give up youth. If you want God, you're going to have to give up sports. If you want God, you're going to have to give up having a good time. If you want God, you got to give up dreams and goals and ambitions. And nothing could be further from the truth, because it's God that gave you the dream. It's God that gave you the ability. It's God that gave you the capacity to imagine a better life than you were in right now. There are those who thought that if you get saved, you can't have any money. If you get saved, you got to get ugly for Jesus. Well, let me tell you about getting ugly for Jesus. Anybody that's getting ugly for Jesus, what they mean, or at least what they should mean, is that when they praise God and when they worship God, they don't care what they look like. They don't care what anybody thinks about them. They're not talking about not combing their head. If they're not combing their head, they're not getting ugly for Jesus. They're just ugly. You understand what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Get ugly for Jesus means when I give him my praise, I don't worry about how dignified I may or may not look to you. As long as he appreciates what I'm doing, to God be all of the glory. That's why I've told the saints down through the years, if you want to catch me sharp, catch me when I come in, because I'm not promising you what I might look like when I get out of here, because I plan to give him my best praise and my best worship. And so it is, my brothers and sisters. There are those who try to make our God undesirable. And you're the ones I came to preach to. And if you do desire him, I came to talk to you for the benefit of somebody else. The only reason why they don't think they want him is because they have not identified him yet. They don't know who he is yet. They have not had a real encounter with him yet. If you get a chance, go back and read the book of John, and you will find that throughout the book, various people don't know who he is. And so they treat him one way. Then they find out who he is and they relate to him a totally different way. And that leads us to the woman at the well. The Bible says that the first thing that happened, some of you have heard me teach along these lines, when this woman encountered Jesus, the first thing she acknowledged was that he's a man. He's a man. He's a man. He's a male. And he's standing here or sitting here on this well. She doesn't want to be bothered with anybody. She's at the well in the middle of the day. It was not customary for women to get water at the middle of the day. They either got it in the morning or in the evening. Here she is coming at the middle of the day. Have you ever been in a situation where you deliberately choose a time to take care of your business when you know other people aren't around because you don't want to be bothered? This girl didn't want to be bothered, and so she was going about taking care of her business. But instead of being left alone, here's a man sitting on the well. What's he doing here? I thought I could get my water and go on my way. Then secondly, not only does she notice he's a man, but she recognized upon getting closer that he's a Jewish man. He's dressed like a Jew. His hair is like a Jew. His robe is like a Jew. And now she's starting to draw up, because she said, not only is he a man, he's a Jewish man, and I'm a Samaritan woman, and Samaritans and Jews don't have dealing with one another. But how many know that the closer she gets to Jesus, the closer she's getting to her life changing? So now she knows he's a man, and now she knows he's a Jewish man, and he begins to speak to her. The Bible doesn't say that she started the conversation. He started the conversation. He said, give me to drink. And the Bible says she responded, she said, how is it? How is it? Now, all he asked her for was water. He didn't say anything about what color, what ethnicity, what language. He just said, may I have some water, please? And she goes off, how is it that you, being a Jewish man, asking me for water, a Samaritan woman? Jesus says, if you knew the gift of God, what did he say? If you knew, if you had a revelation. Come on, I'm still in the same lesson. If you had an understanding of who I really am, you'd ask me for water, and I'd give you water where you wouldn't have to come back to this well. And the Bible says that she says this. She said, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Are you greater than our father Jacob? When you wanna hold back on God, you begin to compare God to other stuff. I don't have time to deal with this, but the Bible says, she says, are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus said, the water of this well, if you drank of it, you will thirst again. But if you drink of the water that I give you, you will never thirst again. But the water that I give you shall be in you a well of water springing up into everlasting life. And the Bible said, the woman said, all right, give me some of that water so I won't have to come back here and I won't have to draw anymore. And Jesus said, go get your man. Go get your man and come for the water. Hey, Lord, I praise your name. And the Bible teaches us that the woman said, I have no husband. Now, wait a minute. Jesus started talking to that woman about water. Y'all ain't saying. And they've gone from water to a wedding. Y'all ain't seen.
I promise you it's going to make sense in just a little bit. Jesus has talked to that woman about water. She says, give me the water. Jesus says, I will, but go get your husband and come back here. She said, I have no husband. Jesus says, show you right. You've had five, and the one that you have now, y'all don't even have papers. He's just a live-in lover. Y'all ain't talking. I'm coming back to that. I want to talk to you a moment about water. I want to talk to you about the fact that 71% of the earth is covered in water. I want to talk to you about the fact that your body, 70-some percent of a baby's body and 60-some percent of an adult body is composed of water. I want to point out the fact that your cells do not function properly. Your brain does not function properly. Your muscles do not function properly without proper hydration. How many know hydration means you gotta have water? Water increases energy and relieves fatigue. Somebody say water. Water promotes weight loss. Somebody say water. Water flushes out toxins through sweat and urination. Somebody say water. Water improves skin complexion. Somebody say water. Water maintains regularity in digestion. Somebody say water. Water boosts the immune system. Somebody say water. Water is a natural remedy for headache, cramps, and sprains. Somebody say water. Water actually affects the mood of the individual who has it. And then finally, somebody say water. And finally, water is good for your economics because water costs less, unless you're buying it from the store, than any of your other sugar-based beverages. What is the point, Brother Blue? Your body has a natural yearning for water. Not only that, but there's a book entitled Your Body's Many Cries for Water. It talks about the fact that many of the diseases that we call diseases are not diseases at all. They are just manifestations of dehydration. You didn't hear what I said. That many of the diseases that we have, that we call diabetes, that we call various other things, really and truly can be boiled down. That your body is in the need that it's in because it does not have water. When God created the heaven and the earth, what does it say in Genesis 1? In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the what? Deep. And the Spirit of God moved where? On the face of the water. Before there was any dry ground. Before there was sun, moon, or stars. Before there were any of those things relative to the earth. There was water. And God brought everything that the earth would need out of the water. God brought the giraffe, the zebra out of the water. He brought the oak and the pine and the fig and the apple out of the water. He brought the creeping thing and the four-footed beast out of the water. Finally, the dust that became your body, he brought it out of the water. So before there was anything, there was water there. Water is the primeval substance that predates everything else in the created order. And so everything that you have is based on a water that you came out of. And so when Jesus is talking to the woman about water, he's not just talking about a little dab or do ya. He's taking her all the way back to Genesis. You ain't sent her to get her to understand that I want to regenerate you. I want to take you back to where you were. There's darkness everywhere. You're without form. Your life is void. But my Spirit has come to move on the face of your water. And I'm about to say to you, woman, you're in the dark, but let
about to make sense, I believe.
It's about to make sense. Thank you, Lord. When Jesus talks to this woman about water, listen to me, church. You could make the case that from a natural perspective, not supernatural, God is, but from a natural perspective, water represents the source of all natural things, because every natural thing he brought forth out of the water. Come on, church. He brought the dry ground out of the water, and the plants out of the dry ground, and the animals out of the are you listening there? And so the water represents source. And what he's saying to that woman is that you are considering this well as the source for your supply. But I need you to know the well you're dipping from is an inadequate source. Hallelujah. As a matter of fact, when you go on and read, he said, go get your husband. Woo, go ahead. Go get your husband. She said, I don't have one. Jesus said, let me tell you what you've been doing. You've been looking for your source in all the wrong places. He said, you've been dipping, trying to find your satisfaction in a man. You dip one time and married Sam. You say, Sam ain't right. You dipped another time and married Johnny. Said, Johnny, you dipped another time. Y'all ain't saying until you dip five times. Hallelujah. And never came up with satisfaction. You came up with a male, but you never came up with satisfaction, because the satisfaction of your spirit is deeper than where you can dip. Somebody in here has been dipping some places, trying to find satisfaction, but what you need is deeper than where you can dip. You dipping into sex, you dipping into marijuana, you dipping into illicit relationships, but there's a deeper place in you, and that's why you keep going back, because it never satisfies. Jesus said, go get your last dip and bring him here. Go get your most recent dip. Y'all ain't talking. He said, go get Walter. Y'all ain't saying. That's as close as I can get to water. Go get Walter and bring him here. Y'all ain't saying. And she said, wait a minute. I've had five husbands. I ain't married to Walter. Hallelujah. Me and Walter just, you know, we roommates. Jesus said, no, I need you to bring Walter, because I need you to see what Walter looks like compared to water. Walter is a substitute. Walter is a wannabe. You've had six imitations, but meet the genuine item. You got the right one now. You got the right dip this time. The old preacher said it this way. When the woman got to the well, she didn't know it, but it was a well sitting on a well. You ain't saying nothing. Hallelujah. It was the eternal sitting on the temporal. It was eternity sitting on time. It was immortality sitting on the mortal. It was spirit sitting on flesh. It was the infinite sitting on the finite. Say yeah, Lord. And so here it is. He's sitting on the well. Thank you, Jesus. And she's been coming. She's been dipping, trying to get satisfaction. And I'm preaching to somebody who's been dipping and tipping and sipping. Ain't going too far. But you've been dipping, and everything you bring up, it won't satisfy you. And you ain't throwing none of them back. Oh Lord, you pulled up Sam, John and Bob, or Samantha. None of them satisfy. Jesus said, what you're dipping in won't satisfy. Why? Because it was dug by your father Jacob. Don't you remember Jacob? He was crooked himself. Jacob had to find his him another well. See, he said, you dipping in your gene pool. You dipping in your DNA. He said, but I got another well that's deeper than your genes. It's deeper than your father's name and your mother's name. And the Bible said that when Jesus dealt with that woman, she got a revelation. She said, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. She knew he was a man. She knew he was a Jewish man. But now she got a better revelation. Now she knows he's a prophet. She said, I see that you're a prophet. And then she changed the subject from water to Walter to worship. Here it is. She said, the real thing that I want to ask you is, where are we supposed to worship? You know what Jesus had done for that woman? He had found, he had helped her discover the source of her dysfunction, the reason why she'd been chasing men, the reason why her mind was messed up, because she had not found her place of worship. She had not found her place of intimacy. She had not found her place of communion. But Jesus said, the hour cometh that they that worship the Father shall worship him in spirit and in truth. And how many know when you worship God, he begins to download in your spirit satisfaction. He begins to download in your spirit peace for your mind. He begins to download in your spirit strength for your character. He begins to download in your spirit courage for the journey. He begins to download in your spirit creative ideas for your business. He begins to download in your spirit patience for your loved ones. And when you leave his presence, your soul is satisfied. Believe it or not, just like your body can be dehydrated, somebody in here, your soul is dehydrated. Your soul needs a drink of the living water. And notice, when this woman left the presence of Jesus, he said, I am the Messiah. When she found out who Jesus was, when she got a complete revelation of who Jesus was, she left her water pot. What are you saying? When she found the real water, she realized, I don't need artificial water anymore. When she found real satisfaction, she said, I don't need artificial satisfaction anymore. And there's some of you here that have been looking for satisfaction in all the wrong places. But Psalm 63 and one says it this way, oh God, you are my God, early will I seek you. My soul is thirsty, my flesh is longing as a dry, hallelujah, and thirsty land where no water is. Shake somebody's hand, tell them it's one thing to have a dehydrated body, but what's worse is to have a dehydrated soul. No joy, no peace, no love, no satisfaction, full of anger, full of resentment, full of offense. But if you come to Jesus, he will give you the water that will satisfy your thirsty soul. Say yes, say yes. Because believe it or not, as water is in the natural, so is he in the spirit. Just like everything natural came out of water, everything spiritual came out of God. Are you listening to me? Your body needs water because your body consists of water, and your body came out of water. Your spirit come out of God. Your spirit is comprised of spirit, God stuff. And in order for your body to be satisfied, it's got to have what it came out of. And in order for your spirit to be satisfied, it's got to have what it came out of. You got to go back to the God who made you. You got to go back to the God who created you. You got to get in Him. Just like your body has to get in water. Paul said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things I become new. I'm going back to where I started from. Somebody said, Brother Blue, I still don't understand why you called the lesson I am that. It is because when you get to know who God is, you will realize that everything you need is in Him. Not because He has it, but because He is it. Hallelujah. He doesn't have love. He said, love, I am that. He doesn't just have joy. He said, joy, I am that. You're talking about healing. I don't have healing. I am that. Whatever it is that your soul stands in the need.
It is our sincere prayer that the Word of God has been a blessing to you as you have listened. And if you would like a complete copy of this particular message or any other such messages or products from our ministry, please make contact with us here at 843-423-0340. That is 843-423-0340. Or you may contact us online, www.dohcc.com. Again, that is dohcc.com.